Well, good morning and welcome to Harvest. If you're sitting on the side sections, how are you guys liking these new seating arrangements? Do you like it? I missed service last weekend. I'll share a little bit about that in a moment. We miss being with our church family, but this is my first time up here looking at people on the angle, but I like it, and I think we'll keep it that way. Well, you know that we're at the part of the service right now where we pick up our Bibles. So if you have your Bible, if you can take it and open it up to what book of the Bible? Yeah, the book of Colossians for sure. And if you don't have a Bible with you, if you've got a smartphone, look it up on your smartphone. We're a church, if you're newer, we're a church that just marches our way through the Bible. And we've been in this series since the first Sunday in January. Can you believe it? And this is message number 4. We've taken a few breaks here and there, but this, or not message 4, it's message number 12 out of 13. So next Sunday, Lord willing, everyone say Lord willing, we'll get to the final verse of chapter 4 of Colossians. But today, we're in Colossians 2, verses 2 through 6. The title of the series is Satisfied, Christ for Empty Hearts. You've heard me say this before, that you will never be satisfied until your identity with Christ is settled, and you will never be satisfied until you are settled in your identity in Christ. When you're settled in your identity in Christ, you're not living for your identity, you're living from your identity. And when you're living from your identity in Christ, you're living as a witness about Christ. And that's the title of this message. The title of this message is Wisdom as You Witness. Well, what does it mean to be a witness? A witness is someone who testifies about what he has seen, what he has heard, what he has experienced. A few weeks ago, we gathered together on a Friday, and we remembered the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. But then we gathered together on Sunday, and we celebrated his resurrection. Jesus Christ died. He was buried. He rose again. Amen? And then he is alive and well, and he ascended into heaven. But before he ascended into heaven, he had 40 days where he interacted with his disciples and other people on earth. And part of his interaction we see at the beginning of the book of Acts. And in the beginning of the book of Acts, Acts 1, verse 8, it says this. Jesus says that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And so the Holy Spirit, Jesus was going to ascend into heaven. The Holy Spirit was going to come and indwell them, empower them at Pentecost. And they were to be his witnesses. They were to live as his witnesses. They were to speak as his witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. They were to live on mission, and they did live on mission. And that same mission that they had is the same mission we have today. And that's what brings us to our text here in Colossians chapter 4, that we are to be witnesses about the Son of God by the power of God through the Spirit of God using the Word of God. Did you catch that? That we are to be witnesses about the Son of God by the power of God through the Spirit of God using the Word of God. Colossians 4 says this. It says, if you follow along as I read, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray for us, that God may open to us a door to the Word, to declare the mystery of Christ on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of time. Let your speech be always gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer each person. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Word. We thank you for your Spirit. We ask that your Spirit would illuminate our minds and our hearts today to hear from you, to see truths in your Word today. God, would you give us a conviction? Would you give us a passion to truly live as your witnesses in the sphere of influences that you have given to us? God, we thank you for this opportunity to be together as a family, and to hear from you. Speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, if you're taking notes, and I hope that you are, point number one is this, is that we need to pray intentionally. We're going to be looking at four points of wisdom as it relates to our witness, and it starts here, pray intentionally. Where do I get that? Well, that is in verses 2 and 3. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison. That to pray is not for man's will get done in heaven, but for God's will to be done on earth. Prayer is not telling God what to do or what to give us. Prayer is asking for God that which he wants to already do and to give according to his will. And so here we see praying intentionally, and there's several aspects of praying intentionally. If we were to just take it word by word, it starts here with that we need to be steadfast. Verse 2, continue steadfastly. When I think about continuing steadfastly, there's a sense of a frequency as well as duration. Frequency in that we are to continue steadfastly, that we're not to just pray before a meal or pray before we go to bed, but we are to live prayer-filled lives, that we are to have prayer-filled hearts where we are praying to God throughout the day. This is where Paul talks about in 1 Thessalonians that we are to pray without ceasing. So there's a sense of frequency. But I think what Paul is referencing here in terms of continue steadfastly is not just praying with frequency, but praying with duration, with perseverance, with endurance, not giving up. Now, marathon runners would tell you that a marathon is 26.2 miles, and once you hit like mile 20, 21, 22, you hit the wall. Your legs begin to lock up and your muscles tighten so much so that it's even hard to even take the next step. But a lot of marathons, there are people that are lining the streets and they're cheering for these marathon runners. Easy for them to say don't give up. Easy for them to say keep going. But it helps that encouragement to persevere to get to the end. I share that illustration because I know that illustration firsthand. I've run a few marathons myself. But more than just running a few marathons, I've thought about this week, that I have prayed many marathons in my lifetime. I think back to 1997, 98, 99, entering into 2000. Praying a marathon month after month. God, would you allow us to conceive? Month after month, the heartache, the disappointment. God, do you hear our prayers? Jonathan was born on November 5th, 2000. What a great day. But his first 10 days were in the NICU. He was born on November 5th, 2000. He was born 2 days before the Bush-Gore election. You remember that? Remember the hanging chads in Florida? We weren't all that interested in hanging chads. We were interested in the survival of our son. He had an IV that was put into his skull in the soft part of the head before it was even fully formed over. And we held him day by day. If you would have told me on day 3 that he would be fine and go home at day 10, it would have been easy, right? Praying a marathon prayer. Day 3, day 4, day 5, day 6. I think about a more recent illustration, maybe involving many of you. 2014, 2015, 2016. Many of you know that this church family, our campus, started in a TV studio just a couple miles north of here, and we were needing to find a new church home, a new location, and we started to pray that God would provide the right facility at the right price, at the right location, in his right timing. Was his right timing to do it immediately? No. And so we prayed and we prayed and we prayed marathon prayers. Continue steadfastly in prayer. You see God's provision of where we're at today, and we're thankful to God for his goodness and his faithfulness. Amen. What is it that you are marathon praying about? What is it that you need to remain steadfast in prayer about? Maybe it's a child who's a prodigal who was raised in your home to follow the Lord but isn't walking with the Lord today. Maybe it's a health crisis. Maybe it's an extended time of unemployment. Maybe it's a trial that never seems to end. Maybe there's strife in the marriage. What is it that you need to continue to remain steadfast in? Pray intentionally. Be steadfast. A point, or the bullet point under that, the next thing that we see as it relates to praying intentionally is that we need to be alert. Be alert. Do you see this? It says, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it. To be watchful means to stay awake. It's probably good advice not just for prayer but for sermon listening this morning. So if anyone is falling asleep next to you, now is the time to nudge them and make sure that they're staying awake, that they're staying alert. Last weekend, we had the opportunity as a family, I said that we weren't here, that we were actually in Virginia. We were at Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia, and our son Jonathan, our oldest, went through an online academy for high school, and he graduated not only with his high school diploma, but his Associate of Arts degree already when he's 18 years old as he's graduating college. So we had the opportunity to go to Liberty, and he was a part of 8,500 graduates in a massive stadium. And the commencement speaker was none less than our sitting vice president, Mike Pence. And you can imagine the Secret Service that were all around and everything that you had to do to get into the stadium because the vice president was there to give the commencement address. Well, interestingly enough, one of Mike Pence's own Secret Service, the one who's in charge of his motorcade, is a student that I had as a youth pastor back in the early 90s. And this is Aaron, and we got to meet up with Aaron there, and he showed us a little bit of the motorcade, and it was a pretty awesome thing to see that. But you think about the Secret Service. You think about them being watchful, being alert, being aware. It's that kind of a thing that Paul is writing when he is saying, be watchful, that we need to be alert physically, not dozing, right, not sleeping, that we need to be alert mentally, not drifting. How many of you have ever experienced prayer and next thing you know that your mind is going in all sorts of different directions? Don't leave me up here alone. That happens to me all the time, right? And one thing that I've discovered in that is just that I need to not just pray in my mind, but I need to pray with my lips. And if I'm talking out my prayers, I'm less likely to be drifting. Or if I'm writing out my prayers, it's helping me to focus. That we need to be alert physically, not dozing. We need to be alert mentally, not drifting. We need to be alert spiritually, not duty. Not just saying the same things over and over again, but being fresh and being alive. And this is what Paul is saying here, is that we need to be alert. Be watchful. A couple of quick resources that might help you to be alert would be to get a book like this, A Diary of Private Prayer. If you're a graduating high school student, Pastor John is going to give this to all of our high school students, graduates, next Sunday. Or just to have a normal journal and just write out your prayer request. This bookmark is always available at our Resource Center, and there's a special table in the lobby today if you want to pick it up before you leave. And it just talks about praying on your knees and praying on the go and how to pray every day of the week for different things. These are some tools, some resources to be able to help you to stay alert. So be steadfast, be alert, be thankful. Notice it continues to say, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is a key theme in the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, it talks about that we are to have thanksgiving. In Colossians chapter 1, verse, who's got it for me. In verse 12, giving thanks to God the Father. And then in Colossians 2, verse 6, verse 7, it says, abounding in thanksgiving. A couple of weeks ago in Colossians chapter 3, that we're to be thankful. And verse 17, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Now here in verse 2, with thanksgiving, that we are to be filled with thanksgiving. My wife has done a great job decorating our home, and she bought this a few years ago, and it hangs near our door that goes out to our garage. It says this, it says, there is always, always, always something to be thankful for. Lift up your voices and let's just read this. There is true, right? So I see this every day, but if you see something every day, you hardly notice it, right? But a couple of days ago, I stopped in my tracks, and I stopped, and I thought about that. I was getting into my van, and I was actually driving here, and I started praying and saying, thank you, God, for my salvation. Thank you that you chose me, that I am holy, that I am beloved, that I am forgiven by you. Thank you, God, for your presence. Never will you leave me. Never will you forsake me. Isaiah 41:10 says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you by my righteous right hand. Thank you, God, for your presence. Thank you, God, for your provision of an amazing wife and wonderful children. Thank you for this loving and faithful church family that you have allowed us to be a part of. Thank you, God, for my health. Thank you for your provision, for your blessings. God, thank you for your promises that you're going to work all things together for good according to those who are called and according to your purpose. Oh, that we would have thankful hearts, and that our prayers wouldn't just be about demanding of God what we need from him, but that we would be quick to say thank you. Thank you for who he is and for what he has done, that we need to be thankful. So we need to pray with intentionality. We need to be steadfast. We need to be alert. We need to be thankful. We need to be specific. And you can see this right here in the text. Paul gets into some very specific things. He says, at the same time. So as you're praying for yourself in these ways, at the same time, pray for us. Pray for me. And Paul is asking them to pray for him. And sometimes maybe I'm not always quick to ask for prayer from other people. And this week I emailed some of our leaders and I was pretty transparent. And I just said, would you pray for me about some very specific things? That I hope that you would be praying for me, that I would be praying, that I would be filled with wisdom and discernment and the knowledge of God's will, that I would have endurance with patience and much joy like we've already learned in Colossians 1. In Colossians 3, that I would put off the sins of the flesh and put off the sins of the tongue, and that I would put on Christ and compassion, kindness, humility, patience, meekness, and that I would have those qualities in my life. And so I would encourage you to pray for me, but not just pray for me, but pray for our elders and for our deacons and for our leaders and pray for each other. And so as you pray for yourself, don't not only pray for yourself, but pray for other people. And Paul is writing this to the church in Colossae, and he's never even met the church in Colossae. Chances are, what we believe from history is that Paul went to Ephesus, a town not too far from Colossae, and he was preaching the gospel, and there was a guy, Epaphras, who came and heard the gospel and took the gospel back to Colossae, and Paul moved on in his missionary journey, and now Paul is in Rome, and he's in prison in Rome, and he's writing to this church that he's never met, but he is praying for them, and he's giving them some instructions, and now he's asking them to pray for him. And as he's in prison, Paul is saying to him, notice right here in the text, do you see it? In verse 3, it says this, and pray that God may open us the door of this prison cell. Are you guys not going to storm the stage? Are you not going to have a riot? Is that what it says in the text? Help me as a pastor. Am I saying the wrong thing? Yes, I'm not. It's not. He doesn't say open the door of the prison cell. How many of you, if you were in prison, would you say, God, get me that get out of jail free card? How many of you would be saying, God, would you open up this door? Could God open up that door for him? Yes, has he done it before? God, remember that time when I was with Silas and you opened up the door? Could you just do that, like, amazing miracle again? But he doesn't pray that. Do you think he's uncomfortable in prison? I would guess, right? Is he asking them to pray for his comfort? Is he in jail because of injustice? Is he praying for asking them to pray for justice? What's Paul asking the people in Colossae to pray for him about? Not for an open prison door, but for what? An open door to the gospel. And he's looking for gospel opportunities. What if we stopped praying for better circumstances and started praying for gospel opportunities no matter what our circumstances? What if rather than praying for just healing from our cancer, we would pray that God would use the cancer to be a witness to other people? What if we started praying for gospel opportunities with our neighbors and in our neighborhood? Don't you think Paul has done a lot in his life? He's had lots of different missionary journeys, started lots of churches. Don't you think Paul could be like, I've done all of that? But yet Paul is always saying, pray for another opportunity, pray for another opportunity. What is it that's holding you back from praying for gospel opportunities each and every day? Can you imagine what God could do in our lives if we were to every day be intentional in our prayers? And that we would be praying that, God, would you give me an opportunity today to be a witness for you? Whether it's at work, whether it's at school, whether it's in the neighborhood, whether it's on the phone with somebody, God, would you give me an opportunity to be a witness for you today? Wisdom as we witness, it starts with praying intentionally. A second thing is this, is that we need to communicate clearly. We need to communicate clearly. Notice what Paul says, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Not just praying for open doors, but praying for an open mouth and praying for open hearts. If God were to open doors, we need to open our mouths. And so he's asking that God would give him clarity. How ought Paul to speak, church? How ought he to speak? He ought to speak what? Clearly. How ought we to speak, church? We ought to speak clearly, not in Christian cliches, not rambling, but clearly, plainly, easily understood by others. We need clarity, not only in our delivery, but also in our content. So as we think about clarity, let's think about it this way. We need to communicate clearly the gospel. We need to keep it about Jesus. The main question that we always need to be getting back to, the main question in life is this. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? Do you remember Jesus with his disciples in Matthew chapter 16? He said to his disciples, who do people say that I am? And they said, well, some say that you're Moses, some say that you're Jeremiah, some say that you're one of the prophets. And Jesus wasn't really all that interested in the pollsters, though, right? And Jesus turned the question. He didn't just say, who do people say that I am? What did he say to his disciples? Who do what? Who do you say that I am? And Peter stood up and he said what? He said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the number one question in life that each person needs to answer for himself or herself. Who is Jesus Christ? If you were to ask people who is Jesus Christ, chances are you're not going to find many people that are going to deny that he was a historical figure. The very fact that our counting system, our dating system annually is based on the fact that Jesus Christ lived here on earth. Most people would say that he's a good moral teacher. But Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So if Jesus is claiming to be God, and he's not,
then Jesus is what? He's a liar. Or someone today would be like, I'm God, and we would think that they're crazy, and we would say that they're a lunatic, and let's try to find some mental help for that person. Some would say that Jesus was merely a legend. Yes, he existed, but he didn't do miracles. Those things were kind of like added, and he's just this mythical figure. Who is Jesus? Is he a liar? Is he a lunatic? Is he a legend? Or is he who Peter said that he was, who Jesus claimed to be, that he is the Lord? That when we're talking about the gospel, we always need to talk about Jesus. That always needs to be our framework. That always needs to be the anchor point. We can't become distracted with political and social issues. We can't even become distracted with things of theology where we're trying to explain the Trinity. We need to keep coming back to who is Jesus Christ. And if we can keep the main thing, we realize that sometimes in our conversations we're planting a seed. Sometimes we're watering a seed that was planted in someone's heart when they were a child, when they went to church, to Sunday school. And sometimes God's going to give us the opportunity to reap the harvest. And I'll talk about that in a moment. But we need to, as we think about clarity, we need to be clear about Jesus. Clear about the gospel. We need to be clear about our own testimony, our own story. You've heard me say this before, that a natural three-point outline is I once was, but Christ and now. Who were you? What did Christ do in your life? And what is the result? It's not just about this is when I came to Christ. That's not always the testimony. Sometimes the testimony is about what he's doing in your life now. And I once was addicted, but Christ has set me free. I once was guilty, but Christ has forgiven me. I once was hurt and wounded, but Christ has healed me. I once was victimized, but now I'm a victor. And it's helping people to see in an authentic way what Christ has done in your life in a clear way. And then we need to clearly communicate an opportunity to respond. That as we talk to people, we need to be asking them, do you believe this? What is it that would be hindering you from giving your life to Jesus today? And to take time to listen to them and help to unpack of those things. That if we're going to have wisdom in our witnessing, we need to be clear. We need to speak clearly. Speak clearly about Jesus in the gospel. Speak clearly about our testimony. And speak clearly about an opportunity to respond. And third point is this, is that we need to live wisely. We see this in the next verse, verse number 5. It says this, to walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of time. It's not just about our talk, but it's about our walk. It's about how we live that matters. When he's talking about outsiders, he's talking about those who are outside of the faith. Today we might say non-Christian, Christian, lost, found, unsaved, saved. Here he's just saying outside of the faith and those who are inside of the faith. Have you ever found yourself in a context where you have been on the outside? You remember when you were first married into that crazy in-law family? And that first Thanksgiving that you had and you felt totally out of place outside of that family? You didn't understand maybe some of the traditions that were going on. And remember being new in a setting and not always having the understanding of the history of the people. Remember what it feels like to be on the outside. I wonder what it's like for someone to come into this church for the first time. They may not even know why they're even coming to church today, but they see these three giant crosses on the corner and they feel compelled to come to church. But they feel on the outside. Think about the person who comes with a hurting heart, with a lonely heart, with a questioning heart, with a skeptical heart, with a hard heart. What's it like to come from the outside? And maybe not even here in this room. Maybe these people are at your workplace or in your neighborhood. How can we walk in wisdom, in love, and in graciousness, and in welcoming attitude towards people to help them not to want to be on the outside, but to feel like they're welcomed on the inside? That if we're going to walk in wisdom, notice what it says here in the text, that we need to make the best use of time. This means that we need to be aware of the preciousness and the brevity of time. Living wisely is being aware of the preciousness and brevity of time. We have so little time to accomplish all that God wants for us. Psalm 90:12 says this, "So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to learn wisdom. Lord, help me to grasp how short life is so that I will have the right priorities." Now this week, Camille and I were looking at each other, and our eighth grade daughter was graduating from junior high school on Thursday night, and we said to each other, we're like, how in the world do we have a graduating senior, a 10th grader going into 11th grade, and now an 8th grader going into 9th grade? How is it that we got this old? And it's not just we've gotten old, they've gotten old. And then the next day, I got an email from Shutterfly. How many of you ever gotten like emails from Shutterfly or Facebook? Like, this is your life 8 years ago. Well, this was our life exactly 8 years ago. This is in 2011, and we had gone to Washington, D.C., which is crazy because we were just there a week ago. But these are our kids in fourth grade, second grade, and kindergarten. This is 2011. Our Aurora campus started in 2011. This is the ages of our kids when we first became a part of getting this campus going. And this campus has been our life, and our kids have grown up here, and it's been such an amazing thing for our family. And to look back on that, but then to think about how fast time flies. How many can feel that? It's like, how in the world did they go from this to the next picture? To that. The preciousness and the brevity of time. Live wisely, making the best use of time. John 9 says this, it says, "Work while it is day, for the night is coming where no man can work." There are two things that last forever. What are the two things that last forever? The two things that last forever are the Word of God and the souls of people. What are you doing to invest in things that will have eternal value? Living wisely, making the best use of time. And point number four is this, speak graciously. Verse 6, "Let your speech always," notice that word always, "be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person." Obviously, we're to be gracious with our spouse and gracious with our kids. We're supposed to be gracious with one another within the church, but the context here is really clear that we're to be gracious with those who are unbelievers. And notice what it says. It says that we're to be gracious, seasoned with salt. Salt was a preservative. It was also a seasoner. How many of you like salt? How many of you like salt? Look at all those hands that are up. Okay, so I need one of your hands who just was up to come up and allow me to pour this salt down your throat. Anyone? You just said you like salt. Who's going to come and volunteer for that? No one? Do I need to call out somebody? Of course, you're not going to come up and do that. What if I were to pour a handful of salt and say, do you like salt? You're like, yeah, I like salt, and then I throw it in your face. But what if I had a hot ear of corn dripping with butter? I say, do you want some salt? And I season it as you turn the corner of the cob. Or those hot, crisp waffle fries from Chick-fil-A. It's a safe illustration because you can't go there right now. It's a Sunday. Say, would you like some salt on your French fries? Salt is the message. It's the truth. Graciousness is the method. But how many Christians are full of salt but lacking the graciousness? They're full of truth but lacking the love. How many non-Christians don't know what Christians really believe? All they know is about what Christians are against. How many Christians try to throw things down someone's face? They wound up injuring others and creating a distaste. Jesus was full of grace and full of truth. And because Jesus was full of grace and full of truth, he was able to answer each person. Notice that's what it says here in the text. That you would be seasoned with salt so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Think about Jesus and Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He was one who had credentials of religiosity. Look at all the things that I have done. God certainly is pleased with me. I have earned my way. And what did Jesus say? In a very gracious way, but full of truth. That you need to be born again. You remember the woman at the well? The disciples had gone into a sidecar to get the box lunch to go. They're on a journey, and Jesus sits at the well kind of as a rest stop, and a woman comes and draws the water, and he begins to interact with her about water, and it turns into a spiritual conversation. He's asking questions, and she's talking about worship, and Jesus says, you worship who you do not know. Think about how gracious Jesus was, yet truthful. Remember the woman who was caught in adultery, who was dragged out of the bed and thrown out in the public square and there to be shamed by everyone, and Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. It wasn't about the condemnation. It was about the grace, but it was full of truth. Who was the wee little man? I forget his name. What was his name? Zacchaeus. He was a what? Wee little man. And what did he do? Climbed up into a... Because he, Lord, he wanted to, and as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, Zacchaeus, you come down because I'm going to your house today. I just want to spend time with you. I want to get to know you. I want to build a relationship with you. Full of grace in truth. That's what Jesus wants us to do. As we interact with different kinds of people, it's different interactions with people because they're coming from different places, but entering into their lives full of grace, yet full of truth as well. Remember our verse that we read at the beginning? It was from Acts 1, verse 8, Jesus says that you will receive the Holy Spirit and you'll get power and you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Well, the ends of the earth is like a global thing, right? Praise God for our ministry, our partnership with our church, Harvest, Timisoara, and they're doing well, and they bring their greeting to us, and we're grateful for our support and our encouragement. And you think about Judea and Samaria, those are like regions, those would be like counties, and so we praise God for what he's doing in Rolling Meadows and Niles, and in the cathedral in Cook County, and Deerfield Road up in Lake County, and in Crystal Lake up in McHenry County. That's Judea and Samaria. Well, what's our Jerusalem? Our Jerusalem is right here. It's right here in Aurora. It's our own neighbors. It's our own neighborhoods. It's our workplaces. That God has called us to be witnesses in our own communities. This is a prime time for us to reach our communities for Christ, not retreat from our communities. Amen? And so what does that look like? Well, it begins with praying intentionally, right? And speaking clearly, living wisely, and being gracious with people. But it also involves, I think, some thinking about the summer season that's coming in front of us. Think about the next 3 months that we have. If you're anything like me, you hardly see your neighbors in the wintertime because who wants to be outside in negative 20 degree weather with swirling winds, right? But then the weather warms up and there's interaction with our neighbors. What if we were to see this summer as an opportunity to be a witness for him? When you came in today, along with your sermon notes, you got a bookmark. And on one side, it has our verse for today, and then on the back side is witness. Pray for an open door, an open mouth, an open heart. Who is it that maybe over the next 90 days, if you were to pray intentionally, do you think if you were to pray, God, would you give me an open door for a gospel opportunity? You think God would open up a door? And that it wouldn't be just, God, would you open up a door, but would you open up my mouth? And then, God, would you open up a heart? Maybe these would be family members. Maybe these would be neighbors or coworkers. Maybe someone on your kid's soccer team, another family or something like that. But who is it that if you were to be intentional about, could God use you as a witness for them? We have some finances that have been made available to our campus through our Closer campaign. I'm grateful for that. And what is it that we could do as a campus to better reach our community here for Christ? I'd love to interact with you if you have some ideas about that. What could we do to get outside the walls of our church and to be a witness for Christ here in this community? Maybe you're thinking about what are ways that I can get out and to serve. There's places like Mission Possible down in downtown Aurora. There's a crisis pregnancy center that we want to be partnering with right down Galena Road. That Kids Hope USA is a mentoring program that we do with Hall Elementary School. And there's different ways for us to even get outside the walls, but that we wouldn't just live as insiders in the church, but that God would give us hearts for our community. Now, this campus was started in January 2011. Started with a vision from John 4:35. It says this. Jesus says, look, I tell you, lift up your eyes. See the fields. Do you see the gospel opportunities that are right around you? See the fields and believe that they are white to harvest. Do you believe that God can use you as a witness for him, even entering into these summer months? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you that you are a God who loves us and has redeemed us and has called us your own. God, I pray that we wouldn't just keep these truths to ourselves, but that we would be eager to share these truths with others. God, help us to have a vision to see the spheres of influences that you have placed us in. Give us a longing, a desire, a conviction, a compassion to live as witnesses for you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.